Hello, this is Tony Heller from realclimatescience.com, setting the record straight about science. In this video, I'm going to discuss the very different COVID response done by four different countries. This is the graph of daily confirmed COVID-19 deaths per million in Spain, Sweden, Australia, and New Zealand. Note that all four countries are seeing a decline in the number of deaths, but the number of deaths in Spain and Sweden is much higher than in Australia and New Zealand. There's a simple explanation for this disparity. Spain and Sweden are in the northern hemisphere, and Australia and New Zealand are in the southern hemisphere. Coronaviruses reach their peak during winter. Spain and Sweden are just coming out of winter, and Australia and New Zealand will be heading into winter shortly. First, I'm going to focus on the northern hemisphere countries of Spain and Sweden. Note that their curves are very similar. The outcome has been very similar in Spain and Sweden, but the approach taken in the two countries was very different. Spain has made a very hard lockdown, and they just allowed children outside for the first time in 6 weeks. By contrast, Sweden has taken the exact opposite approach. They've kept children under the age of 15 in school. Sweden has kept restaurants and bars open and tried to keep life as normal as possible. As far as death rates go, Sweden and Spain are achieving about the same result. But as far as the economy goes, Sweden is doing much better. They've done much less damage to their economy. And even more importantly, Sweden has done much less damage to the psyche of their population. The Swedish ambassador said that Stockholm is expected to reach herd immunity during this month. Moving forwards, Swedes are not going to be afraid of each other, which is going to be a huge problem in other countries. Now let's look at the southern hemisphere countries of New Zealand and Australia. New Zealand has had a very hard lockdown, and their goal is to completely eliminate the virus. This has required that New Zealand shut down their borders, which has had the effect of completely destroying their foreign tourism industry, which is a huge part of their economy. The Swedish approach of herd immunity means that the population will not be vulnerable to the virus moving forward. But the New Zealand approach of eliminating the virus means that most of the population will be vulnerable moving forward. If New Zealand continues to try to achieve their goal of keeping the virus out of their country completely, they will have to keep their borders closed indefinitely. I posed the question on Twitter, is New Zealand planning on keeping their borders closed permanently? And someone from the South Island said, good question. So far, we're being isolated from the rest of the world indefinitely, and a large proportion of our people are being pushed towards poverty. I'm very concerned about our government's ultimate goal and have zero faith in them. Now compare this to Sweden, whose plan is to move back to normalcy as quickly as possible. Let's take one last look at this graph. Australia and New Zealand are doing just about the same, but Australia has done much less draconian restrictions than New Zealand has. New Zealand has been praised by leftists for doing an incredible job, but they're actually doing no better than Australia. Sooner or later, both countries will have to reopen their borders, although I suspect both of them will wait till after next winter. I was planning on going to Australia in a few weeks, but I don't think that's going to happen. But there's one key piece of data which is missing from all four of these curves, and that's that most of the deaths which have been occurring among the very elderly population, and specifically in nursing homes. New Zealand and Spain have taken policies which have targeted younger people when the actual problem was with the elderly population not being protected properly. I'm going to Arizona in a few days where deaths have dropped off sharply, and like just about every place else in the world, the problem they've had has been with the elderly population, and specifically in nursing homes. The Arizona Republic newspaper is, however, doing everything they can to keep people scared about the virus. When I was in college in Arizona during the 1970s, we called the Arizona Republic the Arizona Repulsive. They just published an hysterical story about the first under age 20 death from the virus in the state. Reading the articles in the Arizona Republic, their goal appears to be to keep people scared and to keep the economy shut down. Most likely so that they can use the high unemployment rate as a weapon against President Trump in the November election. But if you go to the Yuma County website where the child died, they said, the child had multiple serious underlying medical conditions. So rather than the child dying from the virus, it's most likely that the child died with the virus. Here's an article which describes what's really going on in Arizona. The number of residents with confirmed cases of COVID-19 in the state's largest county has more than doubled since mid-April to 735 residents. Of those, about 25% have been hospitalized and 103 have died, according to the county's figures released Saturday. By Sunday, the number who died had risen to 112. Much as the nation's first major outbreak of the disease centered on a nursing home, the outbreaks in Arizona may reveal nursing homes to be the single deadliest setting for the pandemic within the state. Residents of long-term care facilities account for 66% of the county's total of 168 COVID-19 deaths. Countries other than Sweden have all these draconian policies centered on young people when they are not the people who are at high risk. The key to minimizing deaths and minimizing hospitalizations is to protect the older population, and specifically nursing homes. According to the Center for Disease Control, the vast majority of hospitalizations have been people over the age of 65. If you want to keep hospitals from becoming overloaded, the key is to keeping retired people over the age of 65 healthy. But keeping the working age population under the age of 65 unemployed accomplishes nothing other than destroying the economy, creating massive poverty and homelessness, and creating a massive future health care issue. Homeless people have no place to go for health care other than the emergency room, so we're going to flood the emergency room with younger people who should have been employed and should have had health insurance. The policies which are being taken are a complete insanity. I'm going to finish this video up on the left coast in California. A few weeks ago, California officially apologized for mistreating Japanese Americans during World War II. Japanese Americans were considered a security threat during the war, and families were separated in internment camps. And now, just a few weeks later, California considers people with COVID-19 to be a security threat and are talking about separating them from their families. The state of California is doing exactly the same thing as what they just apologized for doing during World War II. The Swedish approach of achieving herd immunity, if it works, will leave the population free of fear, whereas the California-New Zealand approach is going to keep people suspicious and afraid of each other semi-permanently. In the end, everyone will end up doing what Sweden's doing, because it's the only way out of a viral epidemic. The only question is how much pain and misery other governments are going to inflict on their population while they maintain their state of ignorance. There's a small possibility that the virus will disappear and that New Zealand will just get lucky, but that's not something which you can base policy on. Policy has to be based on high probability scenarios, not very low probability ones. The last time I ate at a restaurant was in Arizona 2 months ago, about an hour before the order to shut down restaurants came down from the government, and I'm very much looking forward to going back to that same restaurant again next week. Toto's not going with me because I'm going down there to photograph the saguaro blooms, and it's going to be too hot for the dogs out in the desert. But I just got Toto a new friend. That's the little tiny Aussie on the right. She's an incredibly sweet dog and is sitting there next to me in her little doggy bed as I'm making this video. Remember to visit Toto on the web at realclimatescience.com. He's been pulling back the curtain on junk science and propaganda for a long time.